Welcome back to The Gist. I'm joined by Sue and Tim Muldoon, who are the authors of The Discerning Parent. So I've got questions for you. So you guys both went to BC. We had this little BC chat.
Yep.
You have three children. Yes. Tell me their ages.
17, 14, and 13.
Okay, so you have, you know, the gamut. Yes. Why did you decide to write the book?
Well, the book was really an outgrowth of conversations that Tim and I, in a way, have been having since we met at BC as undergraduate theology majors, and we're thinking about our life together as a vocation. And now we're in the midst of this experience of parenting, and we're also involved in our professional lives in thinking about how do we pass on faith to young people. Tim was working as a college professor at BC, teaching people who are discerning and figuring out the stage of their life, and I was working in family ministry at Good Shepherd Parish in Wayland, where we live, and having conversations with parents about the struggles of trying to live out our lives as parents and teach our children to live a life of faith in our busy and pluralistic world. And so we're having a lot of these conversations and trying to apply what Tim is thinking about and writing about in Ignatian spirituality with our own kids. Mm-hmm. And so our thinking was kind of translated into our first book, which was Six Sacred Rules for Families. And then they returned to us and asked us to focus on the challenges particular to adolescence. And so this book is about how do we be very mindful of discerning ourselves in this stage of life, which is challenging to be, to be present to our kids, but also teaching our kids to be discerning in their own prayer life and in their own decision making. There's so many choices they face.
There are. And I feel like there's so many voices, and let's be honest, it is not easy being a parent. And there are so many things in the media that says, God is dead, the church isn't relevant,
right.
I mean, it's a joke. How do you tell your kids, you know, and you have one who's going to be a senior, that what you're teaching at home and what they're teaching in church is true and is truth?
Yeah, and is relevant, really, and in some ways is the harder question. I've often quipped that truth isn't good enough. You know, it has to be loving. It has to be winsome. It has to be attractive. And especially to young people, they live in such a complex world. And, you know, the digital media make things even more just expansive. You know, my 17-year-old is very happy to remind me how much I just don't get it, you know.
Right.
So there's no short answer to that. But the real insight that we have come to really appreciate over the years is that through this Ignatian lens, we understand that it's not us finding the right answers. It's really about helping them as young people come to a deeper and deeper understanding of who they are and who God is. And so in some ways, we're brokering that relationship with God. We're not trying to give it to them.
Well, I know, so that's probably, probably Carolee, don't do that. It's on page 65.
Yeah.
But how do you do that? Like, how do you help them explore that?
Well, the first answer is you model it. You know, so for a long time, from a very young age, in fact, we wrote about it in our first book, we started to model the practice of the examen, which is a very, you know, characteristic Ignatian prayer. It's a prayer of reflection on the past day. And so at bedtime, and these when, you know, our kids were 5 and 3 years old when we first started doing this, we'd ask, you know, what's something good that happened today? What's something that made you sad? And what are you looking forward to? And the whole point was we wanted to initiate this process of valuing reflection and going back and understanding what their lives mean and that there's meaning to be found. And then wed that to the question of, well, where's God? You know, where did you find God today in your day? You know, in your interactions with others? Where did you find that you were loved? Where did you find yourself giving of yourself to others? So they develop a comfort with that language. And I think there's a way to do that at age-appropriate ways at later stages into their adolescence.
And how important would you say, I mean, we know how important it is, but to make sure that they're at Mass, because I feel like it's so hard. I'm a CCD teacher,
mm-hmm.
too.
Yeah.
And you have parents with the best of intentions, but you know, sports get in the way or things get in the way. How important is it to kind of tell us, you know, the parents, look, you do have to model it. We do have to show up. That's all.
Yes.
Just show up.
Yeah.
You know, how do you do that?
It's incredibly important because, like you're saying, there's so many things that compete with it. And I was thinking when Tim was saying that it's kind of a combination between expectation and conversation. Like, we're not able to just say, you must do this and you're going to get it and you're going to have this deep life of faith. We have to be in conversation with them, but we also have to have expectations that we need to put them in the presence of the community of faith, put them in the presence of other people who are going to be modeling this and invite them into an individual relationship with God, but also into participation in the life of the community of faith. And if we just keep saying, well, when we can fit it in,
yeah,
there's too many other things.
Yeah.
And there are many times when our kids are sitting there in church, they don't look dressed like I think they should. As the deer.
Really?
They don't, and they don't look like they want to be there. And sometimes they don't, but we just keep saying, you know, you might not understand this now, but we're bringing you here because we believe that this is the best for you. And as parents, that's how we can best love you, is to put you where the best things are going to happen for
so
you.
So Jesus still loves you when you're yelling at your kids, shh, yes. in the pew, and they're wrinkled, and you're like, stop hitting each other.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think that's a thing for parents, too, is they need encouragement. You know, it is a hard world.
Yeah.
You know, their kids are saying, you just don't get it. Mm-hmm. And you're like, really? I get a lot more than you think.
Yeah.
And how do you encourage parents, you know, to keep modeling that faith and to keep their own relationship with Jesus.
Yeah, it's
fresh.
Important because the last thing that we would want to do is say that we've gotten it right. You know,
right.
I don't know if we've gotten it right. You know, time will tell. But, you know, so even the attitude that we're taking in the book is saying, look, these are field notes. These are things that we're observing. Mm-hmm. But we're also drawing from this very long tradition that says, you know, pay attention to experience, bring God into conversation, you know, all these rich themes. And they float to the surface in our conversations, but again, to your question, we want to issue some encouragement to parents to say, you don't have to get it perfect, but you do have to try, and you do have to make it a priority, and if nothing else, what you find is that in practicing your faith, it actually starts to become real in the way that you interact with your teens or with your children. So that's an important, I think, thing that we're trying to do in the book too.
It's great advice because, you know, I think we're all a work in progress, and I've been on a journey, and there was a time when I was not, you know, really close to the church or close to God, and I felt the more I went and received Jesus in the Eucharist, the more I wanted to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that, you know, if people knew that and they knew the joy that would come, mm-hmm. But what a great book. I have to read it. I'm sure there's a lot of things that I'm doing wrong in there, but thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah.
Great to have some BC grads here with us today.
Thank you.
Nice to be with you, Carolee. Thanks.